So let's go back to a geometric. X is geometric with parameter P. Remember that the likelihood function is a function of the parameter. And as Dr. Wetzel emphasized about a half hour ago, it's a product of values of the PDF, or if it's a discrete random variable, I've been calling that a PMF. And in the discrete case, it really does represent a probability. The likelihood function in the discrete case really does represent a probability. In the continuous case, it's not a probability, but we do the same kind of thing anyway. What we've got in the background here is we've got some data. Notice these are lowercase x's. Got data, observed values of x. Little x1 through little xn. We've got observed values for a random sample. So I need the PMF of geometric. Oh, you may not remember that. Number of trials until the first success. So you've got certain number of failures before the first success. And by independence, you end up multiplying the probability of failure xi minus one times, and then times the probability of success once. P times q to the xi minus one. But we really want to get everything in terms of p. So replace q with one minus p. Remember, the x's are fixed given numbers. This is a function of p. And if I were going to try to maximize this as is, I'd need some sort of generalized version of the product rule, wouldn't I? Doesn't sound so nice. So it's almost always, as far as I know, best to take the natural log, the log likelihood function. Do you do this, Dave? Do you? I call it LL of p. For log likelihood?
Yeah.
Okay. LN of L of P. LN of all that. And then we know this, you could say maybe this is the real reason back in what, 10th grade, 11th grade, that you learned the log of a product is the sum of the logs. The real reason for it is this right here, right? Doing maximum likelihood estimation. It's very nice that we can do this. We can say the log of a product is the sum of the logs. Hope you feel comfortable pretty much jumping to this next line here. We also have products within the product. And we got a power there. Okay, you might also want to do this. You might also want to rewrite this product like this. You got n factors of p. That's the same as p to the n. Maybe this is easier to think about. And you've got 1 minus p first to the x1 minus 1, then times 1 minus p to the x2 minus 1, then 1 minus p to the x3 minus 1, all being multiplied. So you can add the exponents. That's why you learned about adding exponents also in 8th grade, just so you can do this. You're adding those exponents. Put a summation sign up there in the exponent. You're also subtracting a bunch of ones. How many ones get subtracted? N of them. So yeah, we're taking the log of that, the log of a product. We can convert that to sum of logs. Log of p to the n can be brought out in front. Another property of logarithms. There's a product there that can get converted to a sum. Take the log of these things. Or this thing, I should say. That crazy exponent comes down in front. That look right? Oh, wait a minute. I made a mistake, didn't I? I mix things up, okay, and I confuse myself. Okay, I was thinking initially of putting the summation sign there because I saw the product sign there, but then I simplified and forgot to erase the summation sign. Okay. Okay, if you have the product sign there, then you can convert it to a sum. And you'd be thinking about terms like this. But I got rid of the product sign and wrote it like that. And so I don't want the summation sign there. So now take the derivative, because I'm trying to optimize it, with respect to P. N is constant, and the xi's are constant. N is constant. The derivative of n times natural log of p with respect to p is n over p. That's a constant right there. Derivative is 1 over 1 minus p, then times, finish it for me, times chain rule, times negative 1, the derivative of 1 minus p, negative 1. So I'll put a minus sign out in front, I guess. And do what you did in calculus, set this equal to 0 and solve for p. Maybe rearrange to have the equality between two fractions. You could take reciprocals of both sides. You could also cross multiply. Let's cross multiply. N times 1 minus p is n minus np. P times this thing is P times the summation. And minus NP, oh, some nice things happen. N minus NPs cancel. We're left with N equals P times the summation. So I guess P is N over the summation. That's a little strange looking. Until you realize, hey, that's the same as 1 over little x bar. Just like we got with the method of moments. Except, wait a minute, where's the hat and where's the capital letter? Well, just convert those two hats in capital letters as a final step. We're after, so what we did here, the logic is we have the data, the xi's, that we thought of as fixed numbers, and we said we're trying to maximize the probability of getting those observed values, that capital X1 equals little x1, that capital X2 equals little x2, et cetera. Trying to find the value of P that would maximize that probability. This is the probability right here that we want to maximize in terms of P, find the value of P that maximizes this. I did mention last time that when you take the logarithm, because the log is an increasing function, if you can find the value of P that maximizes the log of the likelihood function, it will also maximize the likelihood function. So finding the derivative of that, solving for the critical point, gives you a critical point at least. Is it a maximum? It is. We won't go into detail about why. Okay, we could use the first or second derivative test maybe, but let's not bother. Oh, that sounds like sacrilege to a calculus student, right? Because it's like, no, you've got to check that it's a max, or that it's max, right? We won't.